You are a dancer by heart. Big thing. Coming from a family of traditional Indian classical dancers of Nalanda Dance Research Center, Juhu, Mumbai, Vaidehi, you have always been inclined and mesmerized by our own Indian culture. It is not surprising that you have learned three classical styles, Bharatnatyam, Mohiniyattam, and Kathakali from a very tender age, under the initiation of your world-renowned grandmother, Padma Bhushan, Dr. Srimati Kanak Rele, and her academician par excellence mother, Guru Dr. Uma Rele. Currently, you are being further trained by Sangeet Natak awardee and Maharashtra God of Puruskar recipient, Guru Sri Deepak Mazumdar. You are a postgraduate in performing arts under the tutelage of the esteemed team of lecturers at Nalanda Nritya Kala Mahavidyalaya, the exclusive College of Indian Classical Dance, permanently affiliated to the University of Mumbai, and have cleared the national eligibility test. You are currently pursuing PhD in dance under the keen eye of your guide, Dr. Meenakshi Iyer Gangopadhyay. You are a graded artist of Doordarshan Mumbai and have performed at various national and international dance festivals as a soloist, as well as a prime member of the prestigious Nalanda troupe. You are a visiting faculty at your alma mater, Nalanda Nritya Kala Mahavidyalaya, and a senior teacher at Nalanda Dance Research Center's youth hobby classes. You have received several awards and recognitions. You have judged various dance competitions, taken the role of a compere at major events, and have presented lecture demonstrations nationally and internationally for the promotion of Indian classical dance. Thank you and welcome to the Safe Space session.
With God's grace, what I understand of a safe childhood, I know that I've grown up in an atmosphere where I didn't have to fear saying or doing or being myself. Now when I see it, I realize that, okay, those small things, as I said, mom would prep me, mom would make me, you know, wear my dupattas or wear my kurtas and wear my salwars and leggings in Telugu zamane, the salwars and stuff. So I'm sure she had thought whatever that she was supposed to think. But for me, I never felt that, oh, yeah, why am I wearing this? Was never really, it was apna dance uniform, you're performing Indian classical, wear Indian clothes, wear this, wear that. And okay, fine. And so I would be in my own happy zone just dancing. That was all I knew, I think, and that's all I still know. But yeah.
What you have said right now is so important. It is really the adults around the children who have to do all the prep work. Yes. And that is exactly what you have demonstrated in practice with how your mother and your grandmother and everybody else in the fraternity is kind of doing that, because it is not for the child to worry whether my environment is secure or insecure, whether I should do this action or not do this action. It is for the adults around it. And that is why I kind of always question this good touch, bad touch education as well, because you're putting the burden on the child. It is child not for the child to worry whether this uncle's touch is good and this auntie's touch is bad or not.
Yes.
It is for the adult to be vigilant and see, is it a good touch or is it a bad touch? Is this bad person touch. Allowed, this person not allowed to come in near my child?
So
it cannot be just like your mother did that entire prep. Similarly, all the adults have to do that entire prep to ensure that the environment is secure for the child to just be free and dance and express.
Yes. And just I agree. Be the And I would just wait for those claps, you know, after my dance would get over, where people would go like, oh, wow, my day is, it would be so, and I would be in seventh heaven. For me, that was like everything. And for that, I was ready to go through all the preps of wearing dupatta, wearing this, wearing that, because I want to perform in the most traditional way, and I want my class. So for me, it was very, as I said, I wouldn't even think in those days, because things were ready.
So important and so brilliant what you're saying just now, because all we're talking about is how do you teach the children personal boundaries and autonomy. Just like you had the age defined for you that this is, and nobody while you're dancing, nobody can come onto your stage.
Yeah, similarly, yeah, that's my space.
That's your space. So if all the children are just given that understanding that this is your space, whether it can be this close or this close, you define your personal boundary, and it is your autonomy to say yes or no, whatever it is, and nobody can crowd your personal space. And if that conversation can happen, then so much.
I agree. Well, I think even the more I'm discussing with you right now, I'm realizing that, oh, this was meant, maybe now I realize that, oh, it was meant for this, it wasn't, I mean, so it's more of a revelation for me too, all of this, that was done on a very normal way for me, by my family.
That's what the children are supposed to do, you know, the children supposed to just be, and it's the adults who have to make sure.
I agree. It makes all the difference. When it comes to taking up certain responsibilities of the house, I'm also there. It's not like, oh, you are the man of the house, you should be figuring this out. No, I mean, it's a shared, everything is shared. Yeah, that is what equality is for me. It's not one up, it's equal. So, that's the atmosphere I was in. That's the atmosphere I am in. So, for me, it's very, I think that's what it is. Very hard to define. But there are these small, I mean, for me, these small incidences, like laddu dena for a girl being born, or the black coffee that came in for me yesterday. The small things for me are equality, rather than, you know, these high-flown concepts. I feel these small acts are good enough for everyone to be happy and to feel equal with each other. Or even when it comes to our topic of children being mishandled in a way, which is also not gender specific. It's happening to the boys and it's happening to the girls. So you cannot only focus on a particular gender. They're all facing these problems today. No doubt that women or girls do face much more of this because of the society we live in. And yes, the voice should be raised, and yes, laws should be stringent and protective towards the girl child. That goes without saying. But you can't say that if a boy child, male child, comes to you saying he has is facing a problem like this, that owning, you know, you fend for yourself, you're a boy. I'm sorry, you don't do that. So it it goes beyond gender for sure. It goes beyond gender for sure. So, okay, coming to the strata part of it, I don't think it belongs to any strata. It comes out from a mental instability in one person, whoever is the abuser. And the poor child is at the receiving end. It is that simple. It is no strata. It is a mental state. And everybody has a mind of their own, which can get corrupt for sure. So it's a mental state. So that is one thing. No, not at all related to strata. Unfortunately, not at all related to even being educated. Now that is what rather is something that boils my blood more. Because you're considered to be civil when you're educated. But unfortunately, this is not even, blocked out by education. So, I mean, where are you supposed to start? I really don't know. I mean, you all would be the better judge of it, and you all are working so close, so you know. But so for me, it's mental. It's not connected to any strata. And as far as what I have been reading in papers or when I've been following your work, I've realized that it is unfortunately rampant is what I feel our situation is. Because you're dealing with a child who doesn't even understand what is happening, you know, unfortunately. Like if you get robbed, for example, you know you're robbed because it has happened to you. Your money, which was there in front of you, is not there anymore. You are robbed. So you can at least say that, okay, I'm robbed. You can say. Here what happens is the child, I think, doesn't even realize that this has happened. Maybe it is behind getting a chocolate or behind getting a toy or behind getting even a simple smile or even sometimes a peck on the cheek is taken for something else. So the victim here is a child. So I really don't see how would the child even know what's happening to the child. So yes, I believe by the things I've been hearing, seeing, reading, that it is rampant. Unfortunately, it's not coming out in the forefront or in the open because the victim is unaware of what is happening to that he or she is a victim in the first place. It's only when there is some conversation that.
So where do you think it takes place most? Does it take place with strangers or in familiar places?
So that is another thing which actually, I mean, this is a question which I have in my head myself, because after a point, a stranger has to really, you know, do 10 things to get one favor back from a kid. But when it comes to a known person, the kid is actually very free with a known person. So even if the known person is misusing the child won't even be aware. So I really don't know whether we can even say that, oh, the strangers do it most or the known people do it most, because the lines are so blurred about, you know, who feels that way, who does one aim at, who, you know, what do you want in return from the kid? What are you giving to the kid to get this favor in return? There are so many things. I am aware of the laws, and unfortunately for me, currently the way they are right now, I don't see them. It's like being a toothless tiger at times, because there's nothing after point. You know, you can get away with it, and if you can get away with it, you can keep doing it, and if you keep doing it, more and more children are being affected. So no, something very, very strict needs to be there. But again, as I say, like, unfortunately, with the law of the land, where you need evidence, the whole problem here is that everything is invisible. So when you have to provide any evidence of any sort, again, I don't know how would that be possible, because it's an invisible ghost.
Would you think touching the breast of a child while she is wearing clothes, it would be considered as child sexual abuse?
Yes, it should be in my thing. But the motive of the touch should also matter. The reason why. So if it's a mom who's making her child wear her clothes, and if the mom by mistake touches the child, I would like for it for the mom to at least say, "I'm sorry, beta. You know, my hand just slipped." So that the child, I think, understands that that's a place which even Ma is not touching. Yes, the stage, the barrier, the ambit. And that's how it is. Even if it's your mom or your dad or whoever, if you're made aware that, oh, that's your space, nobody should come there, or it's not for everyone to touch, I think that would just solve those extra thoughts. Yes, so I think it amounts
to. So would you think showing nude pictures to a child would be considered child sexual abuse?
Yes, I do. I do.
Telling sexual jokes to a child?
No. What's the need? I mean, I don't understand. I do find all of this really unrequired to a child, because I think the child starts getting, as I said, we are adapting to the lockdown also in such a beautiful way. So the child also starts adapting to these things, thinking that these are normal and this is fine. If such a joke is cracked, it's normal. Why is it normal? Because mommy also says it and daddy also says it and I'm hearing it. And they're always idolizing their parents as children. So if they see all of this happening around them, they find that it's okay. So then even if a stranger will come and show, they will not have a problem with it. So the more you get them, and this is not educating them or getting them acquainted to things. I mean, many people have a habit of, you know, sort of calling this modern, and, oh, this is what we are, and this is how we are growing in the mind, and, you know, But I don't find any of this modern in any way whatsoever. I mean, things which are not, they're not required. It's not about being redundant, but they're not required. Yes, oh yes. I mean, if I had the faintest of the idea, I would want to help out, because if I had thought that there is something wrong, I'm pretty sure that there will be something to it. Otherwise, I will not randomly think of something happening to a child. But yes, I would want to help for sure.
So what would you do? Would you talk to the abuser or would you talk to the child?
I would first talk to the child to, you know, get maybe have an idea of what is happening. But at the same time, I do believe that if there is professional help available, it is available because they are the best at whatever. So if I would first try to talk, maybe without going into in-depth details, because I'm afraid I may not handle it in the right way. Safeguarding the child, forget the abuser, the child. So I will talk to the child on periphery basis, and if I feel that the child is uncomfortable or wondering or something, I would first take the child to a psychiatrist, psychologist, or child health organization who will actually help the child out first and really find out what the problem is. And then obviously move on to the culprit, because you cannot go to the culprit unless and until the child has actually given it out, saying that, you know, this is the person. Because on the basis of mere assumption, even holding someone else up, I feel is unfair. So
it's also true that very often children do not speak up.
Do not speak up, exactly.
Not share, or would not give you any information that you're seeking, which will make you believe that I can go up to the person and talk.
Yes.
In a situation like that,
in that sense, but even then, in that sense, I would maybe devise first a way in which I'm having an eye on the, not me or maybe people around or whatever, we are having an eye on the child. And, you know, maybe it sounds a little, you know, made up or silly, but I would want to create an atmosphere where the child is doing exactly what the child would do, whether the child had an eye on them or not. So that then if the culprit is really misusing the child, the culprit is unaware and caught unaware by us, because we're having an eye on the child. I would prefer, and I hope, I mean, I would hope it works, but I think I would want to have the culprit caught then red-handed, where we're all, maybe like a group of parents or a group of, you know, people around or whatever, have planned that, you know, we all behave in our own ways of behaving, that we don't know anything or are not suspecting anything. And the child is also not really openly spoken to this. So the child is also behaving in her own way. Hoping to, you know, cast a net for the culprit to come in and get caught. Because sometimes, as I said, the laws are so, fragile, that if someone says that I've not done it, he's not done it, unfortunately. Or she has not done it. There isn't anything unless you have evidence or proof. So for me, when we live in the day and age where we pick our cameras and click our selfies and post them up on Instagram, I would use my camera to maybe, you know, keep an eye on someone who's being troubled and rather capture that so that I have proof. And then I can go and, you know, do something about it. I mean, I think this is a little longer route, or a route which is more difficult. But I think that's the only way, because there's no other way. I don't see, obviously, if I go, as the child won't say anything, if I go to the culprit and I say, oh, you're doing this, even there's always going to be denial. Nobody's going to accept that, oh, yeah, you know, who's going to accept? No one does. So I would want to have something to, say that, oh, okay, then please explain this. If, you're saying, and then go, you know, at least have something on video record or a pic or something, picture or something. So that then the culture feels that, okay, we have something. I don't think so. I don't really think so. Like, there have been times when I've had friends in college, and everybody even talking about how when we are traveling in public transport, sometimes things get very uncomfortable. And you don't recover from that either. And that may, out of all that, you know, that may be a genuine loss of balance of someone, because of which the person fell on you or happened to touch you or whatever. But you don't recover from that either. Now, this is done willfully, willingly, knowingly, aware of what you're doing. So I don't think a child will ever go out of, it will ever go out of the child's mind. It will forever haunt the child all the way up till maturity. And I think such a person who, after growing up, will always be afraid of what will happen to their child, because you've gone through this. Or may have issues in your relationship where, you know, even then you're still a little wary of being touched. So it has obviously very, very long lasting effects. I don't think you can go out of it at all. When I was looking at all of it, I thought that the only thing that the DD should ideally do is involve the parents first, where then they can, as I said, then the whole plan of the way I imagine would be the way of sort of catching on the chachu, because being the chachu first, to get your dad to know about it is the biggest thing, where you need your dad by your side and on your side, accepting that something is going on, and then standing up against tragedy. That's what I feel. And somewhere, because it is family, I feel that at the end of the day, even if the mom or the dad, for that matter, have a very open conversation with the chachu, some sort of a closure or an acceptance, or maybe then a non-acceptance and then taking it legally or criminally can be a route. But her sister cannot not say anything. She has to step in. Who's herself also a kid, not really an older person who can, you know. So when it comes to, I mean, if I talk about children, and which we are engaged in our classes at Nalanda and all of that, what we have very much in common is that we have constant, supervision by staff who keep a watch on everything that's happening on every floor. Like, there are random rounds which are taken at the institute, where no one is aware that the round is happening at a particular time. Because if there are timings to these supervising rounds, then the people are aware that this time, okay, nothing, someone's going to come. So these rounds happen at any time. And the other thing that is very popular at Nalanda is that even when the classes happen, we don't take classes with the doors shut. The doors are always open. There isn't a single shut door to any class. All doors open. Certain doors which are kept shut, like the studio doors where there is AC inside or something like that, they're all having these peep-through glass windows. So anybody can peep in at any time into these doors, which are shut due to air conditioning or whatever. So so it's constructed like that. So there is a constant, if in case there is something happening, there is a constant, there is no door which is fully opaque and shut. So the whole space is open. And for that matter, even when we have parents, when they bring the children to us, the parents are asked to sit down in the common area, and they're not sent upstairs where the children are. And the children are upstairs only with the teachers who are taking classes. And if any parent wants to meet any teacher or have a word with any teacher, the teacher is sent down or the parent goes up along with someone. So even if it is a father of a child, for example, or a mother of a child, for example, nobody is sent on top at all. Like there is a complete no. So there is a person who is sitting down who doesn't allow them to go up. It's that simple, which has caused innumerable fights at Nalanda with parents because they feel that we're not keeping them, not allowing them to see their child freely, or many things like that. And I've seen my grandma fight them off, I've seen my mom fight them off, and now at times I'm sent to meet the parents. But we always tell them that this is for the security of your child only. If we just randomly keep sending people on top, if they say they are a parent of a child, we have around 300 kids at a time sometimes. And if we send parents like that upstairs, how are the kids upstairs safe? Because anybody can come up saying, I'm a parent, and go up, and then what? So the rules are very stringent, which are applicable and which are safe. Like, we know it for a fact because we have no adults going upstairs where the children are at all. It's a blanket rule. And it doesn't only extend up to parents like father and mother. It extends up to grandparents also. Even they aren't allowed. Even they are told to sit down in the parent zone and wait. Your child will come down. That's the thing. And as I said, we have constant vigilance with regards to supervisors manning the entire space, the building space. So that helps to be at least sure that there isn't someone from the outside coming in and troubling. And for the inside, we have our vigilance team who's continuously on check. So that these things have helped over so many years. Like, it's been 55 years now, and it's been helping so many years to be proud of the fact that it's a safe space for children. Sexually, I am active. Shoulder to shoulder. My home. I'm a Russian. Yes, I am.
Thank you, Vedehi. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.